Well, here we are again. Another year behind us, another batch of memories to look back on.
Although we've definitely had some blunders, many of which I already talked about in my last video, the truth is that I took a little back for myself this year. Rather than let my sick curiosity guide me toward the turkeys, I made more of an effort to seek out films that I had real faith in. As a lover of cinema, one of the greatest experiences you can have is coming across a movie so engrossing, so fulfilling, so entertaining that you want to watch it over and over again. Did any of those pop up this year?
Well, there's only one way to find out. But first, let's take a fond look back at some honorable mentions.
Deadpool. Are you getting tired of superhero movies and the cliches that come with them? Well, here's a flick that tears the genre apart and has a lot of fun doing it. Ryan Reynolds plays this part with gleeful abandon, his wild energy infusing the character with such raunchy personality that it's tough to picture anyone else beneath the mask. While the humor is a little too juvenile and obvious at times, the sheer amount of R-rated craziness surrounding the title character makes this a refreshingly filthy and self-aware romp that, like the Merc with the Mouth himself, is not afraid to take shots at everyone and everything. Zootopia. Once again, Disney has given us a fast, funny, family-friendly fable rife with infectious imagination. So many visual gags and creative designs are sprinkled throughout this world that you'd be hard-pressed to catch them all. However, what you might not expect from a movie about talking animals is some surprisingly effective commentary on racial profiling and prejudice. While a bit heavy-handed at points, these themes are still utilized beautifully in telling an exceedingly enjoyable underdog story that balances hilarity, heartfelt charm, and social awareness. 10 Cloverfield Lane. This premise practically writes itself. Trapping a group of people in an underground bunker with no idea of what's happening outside?
Genius.
What are you looking for, a raise? Get out.
This story repeatedly plays with your expectations, making you feel more involved with each twist and respecting your intelligence along the way. Unlike in many horror films, the characters are written as very smart, albeit flawed people, and both Mary Elizabeth Winstead and John Gallagher Jr. help sell that with relatable humanity and emotional resonance. As good as they are, though, the one who creepily steals the show is John Goodman, whose unstable attitude and spine-tingling mannerisms ensure that you never quite know what he's going to do next. This works brilliantly in conjunction with Dan Trachtenberg's claustrophobic direction, which leaves you as the viewer feeling every bit as trapped and frightened as the characters. In the end, this is exactly what you want in a thriller like this. The Jungle Book. If their recent successes are any indication, I think we should give Disney the benefit of the doubt when it comes to live-action remakes of animated classics. For the most part. What we have here is an updated version of the 67 film that pays homage to the original while charting its own adventure with endlessly charming results. Beneath the impressive visual effects, there's a clear love and respect for what came before, which comes across wonderfully in the upbeat songs and unforgettable characters. At the same time, this rendition differentiates itself with a larger scope and a heightened sense of danger, which perfectly suits the story and makes the jungle as a whole feel so much more alive. Rather than trying to replace the first film, this one adds to the tale and establishes itself as an appealing companion piece for audiences both new and old. Captain America: Civil War. Sadly, I was not a fan of this one. The plot is overstuffed, too many characters are literally fighting each other for screen time, with many of them having little reason to be there, the action scenes are not shot particularly well, and above all, the central conflict and supposedly mature tone are undermined by the constant snarky quips. I'm sorry, but I am really getting tired of the Marvel brand and its repetitive sense of humor.
He's like a superhero, but his power is that you can't remember him no matter how much time you spend with him, kind of like every Marvel movie ever.
However, I can appreciate how the film tries to mix things up with superhero registration and the questions that come with it. Plus, the overwhelming acclaim surrounding this flick makes it pretty tough to ignore, so I felt that it was at least worth acknowledging. The Nice Guys. From the writer of Lethal Weapon comes another stylish buddy action flick that harkens back to the genre classics while crafting something new and entirely unexpected. So many elements here simply should not work, but amazingly, they do. Russell Crowe and Ryan Gosling sport a terrifically quirky and off-kilter chemistry, the 70s setting is authentically realized and full of flair, and the slick direction and hilarious script prove that Shane Black has still got it. I have not laughed this hard at a movie in a long time. X-Men Apocalypse. While it may not have the intellect or the impact of some other entries in the series, this is nevertheless an entertaining and confident comic book adventure that benefits from the carefully honed finesse of those involved. Bryan Singer's experience with this series shines through in his direction, which he uses to give both a polished element of spectacle to these superhuman abilities and a sense of large-scale menace to a fairly intimidating villain. Although the film struggles to balance its numerous colorful characters, most of the cast remain as committed as ever, with the veterans comfortable in their returning roles and the newcomers growing on me rather quickly. If these filmmakers continue fleshing out this franchise with these kids in the future, then sure, I wouldn't mind seeing a Dark Phoenix movie. Anyway, before we get to the main entries, let me say that I have yet to see Moana, The Edge of Seventeen, Fantastic Beasts and Where to Find Them, or Rogue One, A Star Wars Story, but I do plan on seeking them out somewhere down the line. Now, onward to the main list.
Number 10.
Bloodfather. Ever wonder how Martin Riggs would have turned out if he'd never had Roger Murtaugh to keep him grounded? This should give you some idea, as it centers on a dangerous and occasionally crazy character trying desperately to stay on the level. More than that, though, it's a tale of redemption, of a man trying to atone for his past sins. However, at its core, it's a story of a father working to reconnect with his distant daughter. At the end of the day, it succeeds in all three of these areas, making for a compelling action drama with a shocking amount of pathos. On top of that, it offers a literal roaring return to the genre for Mel Gibson, whose frightening intensity, imposing presence, and soulful nuance lend real emotional weight to an already engrossing affair. By extension, the chemistry he shares with Aaron Moriarty makes the tumultuous father-daughter dynamic all the more believable, both in the heavier and the lighter moments. Speaking of which, the film also manages to be very funny, having a dry, cynical sense of humor that gets plenty of laughs yet never eclipses the drama.
There's some people left me out there to rot. Sometimes I just want to find them and go say hello with a blowtorch.
Oh, it's a blowtorch now.
Yeah, they deserve it.
All right, that's true, John, and it might be fitting, but it wouldn't be proper. You know the difference between fitting and proper?
Well, I'm not a trailer park poet like you, Kirby. You're gonna have to tell me.
Well, it goes like this. I could shove my thumb up your ass right now, and it would probably fit.
Mm-hmm.
But it wouldn't be proper.
With these aspects at the forefront, the few action scenes that we get, as exhilaratingly dirty as they are, almost feel like an afterthought. However, this is no bad thing. Not only does this strengthen their impact in the grand scheme of things, but the story and characters are engaging enough that you're never bored waiting for the next fight. This in itself is an accomplishment, not just in father-daughter action flicks, but in modern thrillers in general. It's rare that one comes along that manages to be as poignant and memorable as this while hardly throwing a punch or firing a shot.
Number 9.
Hush. Now, the home invasion scenario is nothing new, but I can't remember the last time it had me on the edge of my seat like this. A lot of that can be attributed to the protagonist, who, as the title implies, is unable to hear. Rather than use this as an excuse to make her a helpless victim, the writers paint her as a smart, resourceful, determined young woman who just happens to be deaf. It's consistently satisfying to watch her find clever ways of overcoming her handicap as well as her terrifying situation. My hat's off to Kate Siegel for a gripping, authentic performance as well as for the script, which she co-wrote with husband and director Mike Flanagan. What's especially noteworthy is that the majority of the film is entirely devoid of dialogue, which is appropriate and adds a different layer of tension to an already suspenseful story. Much like in Mad Max Fury Road, story and character are mainly conveyed visually, which demonstrates a trust in the audience's patience and powers of observation that I just have to respect. This is further exemplified in Flanagan's direction, as he allows his shots ample time to breathe, giving you a greater sense of isolation and strengthening the suspense in the process. These sensations alone mean that the movie has done its job, but the way it also puts such an unexpectedly well-done twist on a well-worn formula is so impressive that it makes this film a true standout of the genre.
Number 8.
Batman, Return of the Caped Crusaders. What we have here is an irresistibly charming love letter to the 60s Batman series that hits all the right notes and beautifully commemorates the show's 50th anniversary. Adam West, Burt Ward, and Julie Newmar all sound great and step comfortably back into their respective roles. The plot is gleefully ridiculous. The upbeat music, colorful aesthetic, and enthusiastic campiness perfectly capture the feel of the series, and the sheer attention to detail results in a seemingly endless number of nods and gags for fans to latch onto.
Three cat women?
Is that so bad?
Of course it is. Now he has to pick just one. Perhaps not.
Batman! They're getting away with the replica ray!
Ironic, since I'm saying triple.
The movie is exceedingly fun to watch, and it would have worked well enough having simply accomplished that. However, the clever commentary on how The Dark Knight has changed over the years was something that I, for one, did not see coming. The way the writers poke fun at darker versions of Batman is not only hilarious, but it also gives the tale an unexpected thematic impact without sacrificing any of the infectious appeal. This is a movie that brilliantly crafts a guise of unabashed silliness while, at the same time, having something truly meaningful to say about the Caped Crusader and his legacy. Maybe we were better off with Happy Batman.
Number 7.
Eye in the Sky. It's difficult to deny that warfare is now vastly different from how it once was, having become less personal and more removed from direct combat. Seemingly gone are the days of massive armies clashing on the battlefield. Instead, conflicts are resolved from a distance, with politics playing a much more prominent part in the proceedings. And I can't think of a movie that showcases that better than this. Not only is it a biting dissection of the moral and ethical ramifications of drone strikes, but it also serves as a complex representation of modern warfare.
Minister, we cannot have military decisions dictated by government committees, nor can we put on hold a military operation at every stage for legal clarification. You tell us when to go to war, we conduct the war, you deal with the aftermath.
If only it were that simple.
No decision is totally right. Therefore, every strategy is put under a political microscope, with even the smallest change resulting in endless amounts of setbacks and increasing the tension. These moments are made all the more potent by the tightly focused direction of Gavin Hood, who portrays these events in an appropriately grounded and mature manner, a manner that is further exemplified in the powerful performances. Helen Mirren, Aaron Paul, and the late great Alan Rickman are all electrifying here. In fact, all of the actors play their parts with a fitting conviction, completely selling their respective roles. Since these roles are so varied, each of the characters is written with a unique and understandable point of view. I guarantee that you'll be able to identify with at least one of them. After all, people are bound to have differing opinions when it comes to a morally gray situation like this. The fact that said situation progresses in real time at such a methodical pace makes the experience that much more authentic, as it puts you right in amongst the action and lets you contemplate the tough decisions right along with those involved. You as the audience feel like you're bearing witness to an actual drone strike, and the filmmakers smartly realize that that is all you need to create great drama. At the end of the day, that is the best compliment that I can give this film.
Number 6.
Star Trek Beyond. Hey, what do you know? Another 50th anniversary flick. What better way to celebrate the half-century impact of this storied franchise than to give us a movie that essentially feels like a big-budget episode of the original series? With this film, the USS Enterprise resumes its original mission.
To explore strange new worlds. To seek out new life and new civilizations. To boldly go where no man has gone before.
And it's this very mission that makes the movie work so well. Although it's still an accomplished action flick, there seems to be a greater degree of thoughtful subtlety this time around. The increased emphasis on exploration and discovery not only paves the way for some striking new faces, but it also allows for more of what made Star Trek great in the first place. The hopeful themes are culturally relevant, the alien designs are creatively wacky, the universe feels vast and exciting due to the surprisingly confident direction from Justin Lin, and last but not least, the crew members of the Enterprise are as engaging as ever, with all of them getting their time to shine. These characters continue to grow and change in ways that feel familiar yet fresh, thanks in no small part to both the faithful script and the increasingly nuanced performances. How appropriate that, at such a milestone time in Trek history, we embark on an adventure with the same colorful crew that started it all. I can't wait to see where this journey takes us next. In addition, the film offers a very touching goodbye to both Leonard Nimoy and Anton Yelchin, which should be commended.
Number 5.
The Lobster. Now, this is a bizarre movie if I've ever seen one, but true originality is often found in the bizarre. Just listen to this. The film presents us with a society in which being part of a couple is mandatory. If you're single and can't find a suitable partner within a set amount of time, then you're turned into an animal of your choosing. As if that premise wasn't strange enough, the way in which it's portrayed is so unsettlingly casual that I couldn't help but be entranced. These horrifying ideas are not treated with any kind of melodrama, instead coming across as very matter-of-fact. This makes the film very funny in a weird way. The script strongly embraces the element of black comedy, perfect for conveying these absurdist concepts. As such, director Yorgos Lanthimos takes a somewhat minimalist approach in setting the scenes, letting them slowly play out with little in the way of music or cuts, thus further strengthening the sense of dry humor that permeates the whole piece. However, at the heart of all this quirkiness is a hard-hitting deconstruction of real-world social norms. The film tackles the stigma of single life in a way that manages to be quite thought-provoking. Like it or not, there does seem to be a reflexive expectation in society to be part of a couple. The extent to which that notion is taken here is admittedly extreme, yet oddly truthful. We see the pain, fear, and sense of ostracization that can potentially arise from nonconformity and what those feelings can do to a person. In spite of how emotionally empty this dystopian setting can seem, it's surprisingly easy to connect with these characters on a deeper level. Much of that can be credited to the mesmerizing performances from the ensemble cast, led beautifully by Colin Farrell and Rachel Weisz.
We've developed a code so that we can communicate with each other, even in front of the others, without them knowing what we are saying. When we turn our heads to the left, it means, I love you more than anything in the world. And when we turn our heads to the right, it means, watch out, we're in danger. We had to be very careful in the beginning not to mix up, I love you more than anything in the world, with, watch out, we're in danger. When we raise our left arm, it means, I want to dance in your arms. When we make a fist and put it behind our backs, it means, let's fuck.
It's amazing how these two can be so seemingly devoid of emotion, yet resonate so strongly. The subtle inflections and flashes of understated humanity allow us to empathize with them and give us a gateway into this world. And what a wickedly weird world it is. Around it, Lanthimos has created an original, uncomfortable, and culturally relevant work of satirical art, one that I won't be forgetting anytime soon.
Number 4.
The BFG. First of all, this is the new Steven Spielberg movie, so it was a given that I was going to watch it at some point. What makes this one special, however, is that it's very much a welcome throwback to his more family-friendly films like E.T. the Extraterrestrial. How fitting, then, that they should share the same screenwriter. The late Melissa Matheson crafts a warmly heartfelt tale of dreams, adventure, and fellowship with uplifting themes of underdog triumphs that feel universal and timeless. And she does so while maintaining the creatively goofy language and quirky atmosphere of Roald Dahl. Nearly every scene is teeming with whimsical imagination, with the gibberish words and abstract concepts providing an endless source of both amusement and amazement. What's more is that this sense of wonderment is portrayed with such unabashed sincerity and directorial mastery that it's hard not to be swept up in the magic. The way the camera fluidly moves through this environment, letting you take in every gorgeous nook and cranny, you really feel like you're journeying through giant country. However, all of this would be for naught if not for the wonderfully touching friendship between the two main characters. Mark Rylance lends a beautiful innocence and emotional depth to the titular big friendly giant. Every facial tick, every subtle nuance feels essential, and it's all picked up by the jaw-dropping performance capture, making the character feel truly alive. Equally impressive is Ruby Barnhill, whose plucky energy and engaging charisma make her an endearing and hilarious foil for her oversized friend. The chemistry that these two share is a delight to behold, with each moment more appealing than the last.
Well, I think you speak beautifully.
You do? You really do?
Mm-hmm. Simply beautifully.
Oh, that is the nicest present that anybody's ever given me in my entire life.
BFG.
Oh, whoopsie splunkers.
BFG.
How absolutely squiffling.
BFG.
I was all of a stutter.
BFG.
Yeah.
In the end, this is thanks to both the acting and the writing. Not only is their relationship well-developed and oddly believable in itself, but it's also brilliantly painted as the heart of an enchantingly larger-than-life story, one that revels in childlike wonder while balancing adult messages. Splendiferous indeed.
Number 3.
Batman, The Killing Joke. Yeah, another Batman movie on the list, and this one's bound to stir up some controversy. Based on the iconic comic, this film gives us a chilling, contemplative, and ultimately sad story revolving around the Caped Crusader's craziest enemy. But it also expands on the tale in a manner that further fleshes out the main players and lends more weight to the infamous tragedy. A risky move, but the whole narrative is thematically tied together in a surprisingly organic way, conveying a solemn message about the nature of madness, how easy it can be to descend into insanity, and how drastically that can change a person. This is demonstrated terrifically, both in Batgirl's hostile fixation with a sadistic gang leader and in Batman's deadly rivalry with the Joker. Seeing these characters grapple with the worst sides of themselves is endlessly intriguing, as you really start to wonder just how far they're willing to go to find some semblance of satisfaction.
But can we live without them? Memories are what our reason is based on. If we deny them, we deny reason itself. Although, what's wrong with that, really? It's not like we're contractually tied down to rationality. There is no sanity clause. So when you find yourself locked onto an unpleasant train of thought, headed for places in your past where the screaming is unavoidable, remember this. There's always madness. You can just step outside and close the door on all those dreadful things that happened. You can lock them away forever.
More often than not, the answer is disturbing and damaging, and the emotional and psychological fallout that results helps to better define them as people. These transformations are conveyed exceptionally by the electrifying voice work from Kevin Conroy, Tara Strong, and Mark Hamill. I can't say enough good things about these three, having always maintained that they are the perfect voices for these characters, and boy is that ever reaffirmed with this. Conroy lends a unique gravitas and haunting pathos to this more empathetic version of the Dark Knight. Strong brings an emotionally raw intensity and world-weary uncertainty to the headstrong Barbara Gordon, and Hamill is quite possibly the scariest he's ever been as the Clown Prince of Crime, his every word oozing malice, yet harboring hints of deep-seated turmoil that help to humanize this comic icon, and that is precisely the point. Through both the superb performances and the faithfully poignant script, we get to know these characters not as superheroes and supervillains, but as flawed, doubtful people. It's what made the original work so impactful and what makes this adaptation so affecting.
Number 2.
Shin Godzilla, or Godzilla Resurgence. At long last, the King of the Monsters has come home. This is the first Japanese entry in the series since Godzilla Final Wars and the first to be shown in US theaters since Godzilla 2000. That alone was exciting for a lifelong fan like me. But the fact that the movie itself is such an intelligent interpretation of a familiar formula is just further icing on an already delicious cake. This takes everyone's favorite radioactive kaiju and places him in a contemporary political environment. No longer is it simply a matter of trying to blow the monster to bits. Instead, much like Eye in the Sky, the repercussions of every strategy must be taken into account. How much collateral damage will there be? How good or bad will this look from a political standpoint? How involved will other countries get if we don't succeed? These questions and concerns really help sell the idea of Godzilla in the modern day for a new generation. How fitting, then, that it is that same generation that offers their support in combating this catastrophe. The theme of younger eyes seeing things differently than the old guard runs strongly throughout the film, with attempts to destroy the monster by conventional means proving unsuccessful like they always have. As more and more methods fail, a palpable sense of doom hangs heavily over the affair. This hopeless atmosphere is reinforced by how well-realized and frightening the titular creature is. The film features an impressive blend of various techniques to bring Godzilla to life, reminiscent of the inventiveness used in the original classic. Detailed puppets and other practical effects are employed in conjunction with performance capture, with one never overshadowing the other. Similarly potent is the direction by Neon Genesis Evangelion's Hideaki Anno and the Attack on Titan movie's Shinji Higuchi, which does a great job of hammering home the massive scale of the monster. Thanks to some creative camera angles and filmmaking sleight of hand, Godzilla looks and feels colossal. Above all, though, it's the faithfulness to the original vision and love for the series as a whole that allow this to succeed. And I'm not just talking about the familiar music cues and sound effects. The environmental, social, and political messages are eerily evocative of those found in the 1954 film, but once again, they're given a contemporary update while losing none of their power or significance. Godzilla is back to being a disastrous force of nature with a deeper, cautionary meaning behind him, and that is what it's all about.
Number 1.
Hacksaw Ridge. It's safe to say that Mel Gibson has had a very good year. First, he proved that he's not too old for this shit with Bloodfather, and now he's given us Hacksaw Ridge, an exceedingly accomplished war film that's equal parts shocking and inspiring. How, you ask? Well, by telling the incredible true story of Desmond Doss, a World War II medic who saved the lives of 75 wounded soldiers and earned the Medal of Honor without ever firing a shot. Hard to believe, I know. It sounds like an exaggerated fable, but it's absolutely true. And that truth is conveyed here with a tremendous degree of realism and reverence. Doss as a character is exceedingly compelling because he is a pure figure in an overwhelmingly impure time. However, that doesn't make him any less human or relatable. We understand where his pacifistic convictions come from, and we feel the inner struggle that he faces time and time again as he fiercely tries to maintain those convictions in the face of not only his unaccepting peers, but also the hellish horrors of war. Rather than paint him as an unattainable saint that you can't identify with, this simply makes him more intriguing and admirable as a hero. All of this is magnificently anchored by Andrew Garfield, who portrays Doss's wholesome attitude with such personable honesty that you believe every peaceful word that comes out of his mouth. And he's not alone. Every one of these actors brings his or her A-game, with superbly soulful performances coming from Hugo Weaving, Teresa Palmer, Vince Vaughn, Luke Bracey, and Sam Worthington. As a director, Gibson really knows how to get the best out of his cast, probably due to his own history of honing the craft. Of course, another area where he truly shines is in depicting the bloody brutality of battle, putting the audience right in the heat of combat. The film wisely doesn't shy away from the grisly violence, nor does it get carried away with the camera work. We're allowed to soak in every shot, every explosion, every rescue in explicit detail. It's astonishing how these sequences can depict the gruesome chaos of war without ever drifting into incoherence or exploitation. As accomplished as these scenes are, however, they are far from the main point of the piece and are never prioritized over the drama. Gibson spends much more time focused on the characters and their ideals, knowing that those are where the real meaning lies. As authentic as the setting is, as breathtaking as the battles are, the film never forgets the extraordinary story of a man and his astonishing capacity for compassion. At its core, this is a movie about loving your fellow man and remaining true to your beliefs even in the darkest of times.
Please, Lord, help me get one more. Help me get one more.
When it comes down to it, few things are as universally uplifting as that. It's tremendously refreshing and comforting to see a person rush into danger, armed with nothing but a pure and simple desire to save people. If that's not the sign of a true hero, then I don't know what is. Thanks for watching. Feel free to like, subscribe, and/or comment. Until next time.